As 2021 comes to a close, Star Citizen is adding features that are changing the game for good. There is a lot to learn, and I mean a lot. So I've made a new player's guide that will get you up to speed on the basics of the game. I will also keep this guide up to date with derivative tutorials that go into more depth. So if you want to keep learning, check out the videos in the video description and subscribe for more. And if you're ready, I'd like to thank you for coming to my Tomato Talk. And thanks to my newest Patreon supporters, Jua Korkiakowski, Darstick Lorne, KingCoop78, Martin Schimmel, Davok, and Felix Delege. Before we get too deep into this, let me explain the format. This guide will get you started with an account, into the game, and run through the basics of getting a character set up and running your first missions. Each of these chapters will be listed in the video and can be skipped to. As time goes on, I will continue to link in-depth tutorials I create for the systems we touch on in this video. Those will be in the playlist linked down below. Feel free to bookmark this video to come back to it later for more of these guides. I would also like to make it 100% clear that everything in this tutorial is subject to change in the coming years. Things are beginning to solidify in terms of gameplay, but certain features can and, in some cases such as the inventory, definitely will change over the years. This game is still deep in development and has plenty of bugs and nuisances. Sorry about the theatrics, I think the disclaimer is important. Now let's get an account. If you are here for a free fly event or haven't made an account, you can use the link below to gain a few extra credits when you start out. Once you make that account and you aren't playing during a free fly event, you can purchase a game package. I recommend not buying anything more than the initial $45 needed for the game. While these ships aren't the most polished in the game, which they absolutely should be, they will be good enough to make the money needed to upgrade to the next tier. And luckily, this video should get you started on that process. I will present you with an option. If you'd like to spend a little bit extra money for a more solid ship, you could grab the Anvil Pisces starter pack for a normal $60 game price. Today though, we'll be using the RSI Aurora. Once you've downloaded the installer and opened the launcher, you can load into the game. From the menu, you'll be required to pick a home location. As of right now, you'll be limited to the four planets of the Stanton system: Microtech, Arcorp, Hurston, and Crusader. While we're only currently limited to one star system, it is diverse. The planets feature unique benefits, biomes, and experiences. Their styles in clothing, architecture, and personnel also differ quite a bit. As the game continues development, these things will become more pronounced and make a bigger difference to players. For now, it's not that serious, and you'll find the city you most enjoy over time. While it determines where your vehicles and items will begin, it isn't permanent. For now, pick a planet based on what seems coolest to you, and we'll explore from there. Let's choose Microtech. When we load into the game, we'll wake up in a bed in our apartment. We can hit the Y button to immediately get up. This key will be useful in getting out of any seats. Other basic controls include the F key for all interactive functions, including tapping to quickly select the primary option or holding to scroll and select, mouse wheel to change both walking and ship movement speeds as well as charge levels on all tools, and F12, or else public chat will always be in your face. Quick tip, you can also press the middle mouse button in to lock menus to your view. These all are, of course, in addition to your usual controls. Now, before we get any deeper into controls, let's get to seeing the actual game. Wherever you spawn in, you'll be up in the residence quarters of your building. You'll want to find the elevator and head downstairs. Every landing zone functions in this way, but once we get downstairs, things will start to differ a little bit. Here at New Babbage, we have a hospital in 315, as does Orison, but Lorville in Area 18 will be waiting over the next two updates. It's a pretty good idea to always stop off at the local medical center before heading out of the city. Besides the dangers you can come across during normal play, glitches can cause injuries that might need to be quickly healed. Make your way to the pharmacy and use the terminal to select a couple of Hemazol pens for just in case. These are your medical pens that will always stop bleeding when you need and heal your health by a certain amount. In order to use them, you can press the C button and then left-click the mouse to apply the healing. You'll also see a lifeguard medical attachment for the multi-tool. Grab that. And a few refills. The multi-tool is one of the most important items in the game right now. Don't worry about actually equipping this, though. It's not important right now. Before we grab our ship and get out into space, let's head into the city and grab some more supplies that'll help us survive and thrive in the verse. As you move through the city towards the shops, you'll see a lot of that world building I mentioned earlier. While it is oftentimes broken and lacking in many areas, the foundations of what each world will offer you in the future can be seen in some ways. While each landing zone in the game has its own shops, they don't all offer everything or even the same things. As you explore, you'll begin to understand where you might need to go to get certain items. The multi-tool is a universally available item amongst the cities, and at all refinery space station locations. I'll make an entire video on this tool, as it'll come in handy quite often, but you can buy one here at the Shubin Interstellar kiosk on your left, one of the largest mining corporations in the game. Speaking of mining, how about we grab a mining attachment, a tractor beam attachment, and some torso armor? Those attachments will allow you to easily pursue multiple professions later, and we'll need the torso armor in order to use a backpack, but more on that in a second. You'll have a couple of choices for armor, but the MacFlex Core is a good, affordable option. Armor currently is not a big part of the game in 2021, but in the future, your choice of equipment will depend pretty heavily on what you'd like to do out there in the verse. Now that we've gotten our supplies, checked out the rest of the shops, and made our way to the spaceport via the trains below, we can equip all of our items and prepare our ship. Let's get into the UI of Star Citizen, starting with the personal inner thought system. By holding the function key, F, and right-clicking with the mouse, we can open a new UI. This is the central location for all things inner thought, which is basically your interaction in the world. So if at any point you find you don't know a control or how to emote or where your inventory is, just open this menu. All of your contextual controls are available here, and with a right click, each of them can be reassigned to a key binding or added to your favorites tab. I highly suggest setting your helmet equip to one of these favorites. At the top of this menu is the inventory system. This can also be accessed directly by using the I key. It's good to keep in mind that this inventory system tracks your local, ship, and personal compartments like backpacks. So when you need to, you can transfer things from the city to a ship to a backpack and back, nesting inventories inside one another and allowing you to either drag and drop or double click to equip items to your character. But keep in mind, once you leave a city, if you lose those items, they're gone for good. This is true of items linked to your account as well, although they can be retrieved by a character reset. Regardless, it's good to only leave the city or space station with the items you absolutely need. And also keep in mind that as of 2021, your inventory between the city and space station in orbit are linked, so you don't need to carry things up if you were just going to land up above anyways. As you may notice, your inventory is currently pretty light, and while I said we could grab our supplies up at the station above, we'll take some things from here. First, grab that armor you purchased and drag it onto your body. Next, we'll double-click our med pens until we have three equipped. Save the other two for later. Finally, let's drag the multi-tool onto our hip, along with the tractor beam attachment, which we can drag onto the tool itself. Oh, and let's not forget our backpack, which we can toss those medical refills in. And if there is anything you want to leave behind, you can just drop it in the square at the bottom of the screen. Perfect. Now let's get our ship. Each spaceport will have a row of yellow screen terminals that will allow you to call for your ship to be loaded into a hangar. This will also provide a small UI icon to show you how far away it is, and what hangar it's located in. All we need to do is find the elevators and head to the correct hangar. Once there, we can see all entrances to the ship marked with the UI, so we can easily hop on board our first vessel and prepare for what Star Citizen is all about. You don't have to immediately get into your ship though. You've got some time, but there is a point at which the air traffic controller will store the ship again, and you'll have to return to the kiosk to get it.
Initiating ship storage procedure. For your safety, please vacate the area. Thank you for your cooperation.
Once in the tiny little ship, use the normal interaction to sit down in the pilot seat. Immediately hit the R button to turn all systems on.
System check.
There are various ways to power the ship up, but this is the easiest. If you'd like to know the key bindings, you can look at your personal interaction system. Next, we'll open our MobiGlass menu, which we'll get into a little bit later. For now, we just need to contact Control to open up the hangar for us. So hit F11 and go to your Friends tab. Though, don't be fooled, they aren't your friends. You can do this using the screens in the ship as well, but that's a bit clunky, so we'll just stick to this. With the ship on, it's finally time to fly. Whether you're exiting from the front or the top, you're going to want to not crash. So let's briefly go over the necessary controls for flight, and we'll get deeper into it in another video. As with ground movement, W, A, S, and D are your directional controls. You'll also be able to use spacebar to go up and left control to go down. When you want to continue at speed and cruise control, you'll press the C key. Speaking of speed, that throttle button is binary input. So you're either full throttle or you're at zero. Luckily, we can adjust our max throttle using the mouse wheel, as you did while walking. As you can see, the little square next to our speed indicator can be moved to determine max possible speed. This makes it easy for us to lift up off the ground without losing control. Once up in the air, we can take another second to orient with our HUD. For now, all HUDs are the same, but we've already seen that manufacturer-specific layouts are around the corner. So it'll be helpful to get used to looking around a bit. On the screen in front of us, we can see a compass that aligns to the solar plane, or the planet's surface. An altimeter over on the right next to your fuel, weapon, and countermeasure readings. And your ship's emissions output up at the top. Before we head out, let's also raise our landing gear using the N key. The indicator for this is down in the bottom left hand, along with other important ship readings that we can go over later. These are your need-to-knows for any ship HUD, though there is plenty more to learn in the future. First, let's just get flying. Take things easy. Keep your speed and altitude low until you're comfortable. Find some beautiful scenery and just enjoy yourself for a bit. If it's too dark to see the scenery, you can still get a sense of the land by pinging with the tab key. This will allow you to see all detectable signals in a certain area. While I have some videos about this, I'll be putting out a more in-depth guide soon enough. Once you're ready to go, we'll head up to space. Now, like I said, on your way up to space, since you know it's a long way, you can hit the C key to activate cruise control. Scroll the mouse wheel up to max throttle and hold left shift to activate your afterburners. And once you're up to speed, tap F4 to get a beautiful view of the planet as you leave. You can hold the Z key, which is the free look button, and use the mouse to look around as well. Once you're tired of the sights and we've gotten high enough in the atmosphere, we can jump to the orbital space station. To do this, we will use quantum travel. Press the B button to activate. Look for the square somewhere in the sky above and calibrate your drive. This may require you to line up a little weird based on your ship and could fail to start at some point. But if you look away and back at the target, you'll eventually be able to get the jump to work. For more information regarding this system, how it works, and deeper controls, check out my tutorial. Once near the space station, you'll see quite a few white icons pop up in your viewfinder, and possibly a couple of blue ones. Those white contacts are things like turrets that protect the station. The blue ones are other friendly ships, whether NPCs or other players. You can target and identify these contacts with the T key and by aiming at them. Or you can hit V to activate scanning mode and get deeper information. Just keep in mind, when you lock onto a ship, they are notified of it. Again, for more on this, a new scanning and radar tutorial will be linked below. Once you've harassed enough nearby pilots, we can call for a landing at the space station, just like we requested takeoff permission. Press F11 and call your friend. Stay on that screen until you get a reply, and then back out and look for a small indicator showing where you were meant to land. If you get a glitch or can't find it, try again, and fly around looking for the pads themselves. Different stations are shaped differently, so it may take some time. Speaking of different stations, let's talk about them while you're landing. Much like cities, space stations are areas of high security, commerce, and population density. You'll generally come across other players going about various activities, despite the current instance population being just 50 players. But you'll quickly learn that, just like with cities, they aren't all the same. Currently, we have access to cargo space stations, refinery space stations, and regular space stations. Cargo space stations don't have any functional difference currently, to many players' chagrin. But refinery stations will be your go-to location if you'd like to refine your mined minerals freely. The point here is that as the game expands, stations will have different needs and constructions. While they all may allow you to land, refuel, and repair, which can be done in your mobilas, they may not all have medical facilities, armor accommodations, or food courts. And as I've said throughout this video, these things will be important considering your playstyle. These are the types of complications that they try to fit in all your decisions in this game. Currently, the station that you're at is a cargo space station with a medical facility. So let's go set your respawn. This functionality can be replicated in any area with a medical bed of tier 2 or higher. This includes the 890 jump, the Carrick, and all space stations in 315. When changing your imprint location or regeneration point, you're moving your respawn location to that area, as long as it is actively in the game, so be careful with ships. By regenerating at this space station, you can avoid going through that whole process we just did of getting into space every time you respawn. And if you desire, you never have to go back to that city again. And before we leave, go ahead and hit I to get into your inventory. Let's grab the last of the supplies that we bought down on the planet and put them in our backpack. And on the way out, you may want to consider grabbing some food and drink. Then, we can get to running some missions. Once we return to our ship, let's take out our contract manager and look at our activity options. Hit F11 to open up your mobiglas. Here's a quick breakdown of how this device will assist you in 315. Keep in mind, this will be changing over the course of the next year. First, you have the contacts list, opened with F11, where you'll be able to manage parties, contacts, and chat rooms. Then you have the vehicle manager, where you can customize any vehicle that you have access to in your current location. After that is Knickknacks, an app that can track every asset you own and where in the galaxy they are. Skyline is your map, and will be able to show where in the star system you are, as well as your routes, current fuel, and quantum jump beacons. You can set routes in this app, and eventually it will allow for local navigation as well. The next app is MoTrader, which is a currency transfer app, and your contract manager, which displays all available missions. The wrench icon allows for repair, refuel, and restock services at landing pads that offer. To the right of that is your journal, providing important public information such as local laws, which actually matter, and system-wide announcements. On the far right is Delphi, your reputation tracking app. Reputation is a major determiner of what you can do in this game, and something I go over in more depth down below. Let's go back to the contract manager though. This is where you'll be going for most organized play in the game, and has three distinct sections. There's the navigation bar up top that will let you flip between tabs, the contract section, which will display all of the missions in a tab, and the mission description, where you'll get all the information you need on your contracts. Each of these sections is important. Your top bar will let you jump between available, active, and past missions, as well as beacons. The description will tell you key details about your mission, and this is not just flavor text. Pay very close attention to the issuer of the contract and the description. There are oftentimes key hints that will tell you this will be an illegal activity. And that will matter a lot. When in the accepted tab, this will also allow you to confirm which missions you are tracking, and your current progress through your objectives. You can also abandon missions, but that will hit your reputation. As for the possible missions, you'll probably want to start out with just the general tab, as they are mostly simple, safe, and lawful. Your choices here are broad and are changing with every update. First are your delivery missions. These can be provided to you by a multitude of companies in different areas. I suggest sticking with one for good so that you can build a reputation and get paid more for your work as time goes on. These missions are pretty self-explanatory. They will require all kinds of delivery services, whether that be multiple locations, a shipwreck, or the middle of space. They can include volatile cargo, specific travel methods, and time limits. You can get into some commerce, exploration, combat, and social gameplay doing this. It's a great way to see the verse, but not the best way to start making money. Expect delivery missions to continue to expand in various ways as we move forward with passenger transport missions currently scheduled for 317 and data transport missions and I don't know, whenever. Then there are search and investigation missions, which range from simple search and find missions to full narrative investigations with voice acting and story elements.
Thank you for getting in touch with me. My husband recently died aboard the Gundo Kovalex station, but the company is refusing to...
Though these are not very common. These are also pretty low-risk missions and great ways to find local cave locations, but they once again don't pay very well. Bounty hunting is arguably the best way to make money straight from the start, but it carries a bit of risk. This profession also integrates with reputation the most, allowing you to climb the ranks with your friends, earning more money for each bounty level, and encountering new and challenging ship combinations. I highly suggest only taking an undersuit on these missions to minimize your losses. Also, consider taking these missions with a partner until you're comfortable with combat, since the reward automatically splits. But be careful picking these missions. You can hunt both NPCs and players. Don't go after criminal players unless you feel ready. Make sure to take the Call to Arms mission before starting these as well. You'll get extra credits for each criminal you ruthlessly murder, because we don't know how to arrest people yet. Finally, there are mercenary missions. These are much like your bounty missions, but focus on FPS gameplay rather than ship-based combat. These missions require more coordination and risk than bounty hunting, though, as you'll have multiple enemies and friendlies which can present different scenarios. And while you'll have the chance to get some loot on these missions, you could also lose it all. Remember those med pens we grabbed earlier and heal your friends with the multi-tool attachment. After all this, there is the personal tab, which features specific contracts that are only sent to you. Due to this key point, most of these missions are less than legal. While these opportunities can lead to more exciting missions, they can get you into trouble with security or even players. This selection of missions does not remain static. It changes over time and space. So if you don't see missions you like, wait a bit or travel to another location. And as you progress through higher reputations, expect higher payouts, more challenges, and more missions. After you've gotten bored with these, though, there are plenty more things you can do. Exploration, while not featuring any major game mechanics, still has its charm. Whether you're visiting the deep caves of Daymar, the obsidian fields of Microtech, or the derelict ships scattered throughout the system, you'll have a beautiful view and plenty of amazing detailed locations to visit. Mining is a very popular source of money, which can be done on foot, in a vehicle, or in a ship. It uses a deep combination of passive and active attachments, as well as gadgets that can change the rocks you're mining. It is currently one of the more complete game loops, tying into the refinery gameplay that's also currently available. Outside of box missions, cargo hauling en masse on your own dime is an option as well. While risky and somewhat broken at times, this is a relaxing way to start growing your fortune slowly but surely. Just consider bringing an escort. And even still, there are plenty of ways to enjoy the game with friends. While there are always events ranging from small gatherings to huge sponsored tournaments occurring in Star Citizen, you can guarantee you'll find a group to play with by joining an organization. My own org, the Garden Interstellar Initiative, has started recently and aims to help new players get into the game in a friendly and fun environment. You can join us down below, or visit the website page to find an org that fits you, whether for racing, industry, combat, or more. As I alluded to in my last point, Star Citizen can be more enjoyable with friends. There's no reason to avoid playing solo, but over time the game has slowly catered more to those who want to work together. The game is being designed in a way that allows players to specialize in their profession. Since not everyone can master everything, this eventually aims to lead to group play. The game is always developing and changing as well, with quarterly updates to the game and weekly progress reports. So as a newcomer, everything can be quite overwhelming. Luckily, this community is incredibly friendly, incredibly helpful, and ready to share its knowledge and enthusiasm for the game with you. Seriously, ask anybody. People are really pumped to help newcomers around here. So much so that there is a program to help newcomers that you can sign up to. But find an org, find a Discord group, hop on Reddit, or continue perusing YouTube, because there's an absolute ton of stuff to go through after this guide. You've joined the ranks and you're in the game. And even though the alpha is pretty unstable, the fun's only just begun. Part of following this project is being part of the development while also playing the game, checking out the weekly update videos or conversing with the developers, visiting the convention or getting involved in the community contests. There is a full experience here for those looking to get fully engrossed. Or you could just play the game. Regardless, I'd like to welcome you to the Star Citizen community. I hope this helped you learn the game a bit. As I said, this was a very minimal look at the basics, and over the years I hope to fill out my collection of helpful videos that can show you what the rest of the game has to offer. Thanks to my top supporters, TK, Ken Garcia, Valiant 15, The Alpaca, Holston Coop, The Huntress, Dasek, Guilty Conscious, Extreme Tuber 7, El Gordo, Jarzy, Jin, Bilal Eliassim, Brian Peterson, and that Aussie guy.